Can give us colds and cough, so let's be careful and try to drink hot water or tea. Yes. Okay, so you heard that, and shall we stand up, please, and we will continue our study regarding the things that make us unstable. So again, we will read Joshua 1:8, and then we will pray as we continue enumerating these things. Shall we read in unison? Ready, read. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Father, once again, we thank you for another Wednesday night that we are gathered, that we prayed, that we receive and will receive, Lord, your answers to our prayers. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to approach you boldly in your throne of grace, that our supplications, our requests were made known unto thee. And I pray, Lord, that you will continue to help us so that we will grow in faith and that we'll be able to do more for thee, that you may be glorified through the power of the Holy Spirit that is working in our lives. Forgive me, Lord, for my sins and our sins, O God, and make us worthy tonight to receive your word. Be the one, Lord, to bless each and every one of us, that we may receive knowledge and wisdom from your word, that we can eventually appropriate and apply in our everyday lives. We thank you for your love. We love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So last week, we studied about those things that made Christians unstable and not to really have that good success that the Bible promised to those who are going to make the Word of God a mighty part of their lives. We studied about deception, what the devil is using in order to make us unstable. Also, incomplete development or spiritual immaturity on our part, and then our shallowness when it comes to studying the Word of God, serving the Lord, worshiping Him, not really giving our all to the Lord Jesus Christ, and our being double-minded. That is not having a single eye so that we can fix our eyes and mind on the Lord Jesus Christ and set our affection on things above so that we can concentrate in serving the Lord. So we need to understand that there is only one master in our lives, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. So whenever we try to serve two masters, then we're just going to hurt ourselves, we're going to hurt our testimony, we're going to hurt the will of God in our lives, and we're going to hurt people that are looking at us for their growth, for their maturity, and the loss for their salvation. So, one thing that we can add is what we call displeasure towards the Word of God. Displeasure towards the Word of God. You see, the Word of God is the truth. Amen? And most often than not, the truth hurts because though we are saved, we are still in our old Adamic nature. We are still in the flesh, and there is still a battle that is going on within us. The Bible says that the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. So whenever we hear the Word of God, we read the Word of God, we listen to the Word of God, there is always one purpose, and that is for God's will to happen in our lives. If we are ignorant on so many things, the Word of God will serve as an instruction to each and every one of us. If we are committing sin, the Word of God will be a rebuke to us. If we are weak, then the Word of God will be an encouragement unto us. And if we are drifting away from the Lord, then the Word of God is the one who will guide us so that we will go back to the pathway that the Lord has prepared for us. So the Word of God will always accomplish its purpose. So if we are going to let the Word of God guide us, then we are going to become better and we will be able to glorify God in our lives. But it is a different thing if we are going to have what we call disgust, or if we're going to be displeased with the Word of God. Because as I have said, the truth hurts, especially when what we are doing is wrong. So many people do not want to be rebuked. So many people do not want to be meddled with the things that they are doing in their lives. The Word of God is like a mirror. It will reveal to us who we really are, what we really are. And most often than not, we are going to meet the Word of God with hostility because we believe that we know what to do, and really, we do not need God in our lives. But then again, when we are confronted by the Word of God, then we will see who we really are, and there is only one remedy. And that remedy is to accept the Word of God no matter how painful it's going to be. Amen. So you see, in the Bible, there are so many things, so many people who got stumbled because of the Word of God. One classic example is found in John chapter 6, wherein we can see that people are looking for the Lord Jesus Christ because of the miracles that he had done when he fed 5,000 people. And they thought that it's going to be safe to be with the Lord. It's going to be what we call a smooth life when they are going to be with the Lord. Why? Because he can provide for the things that they need. And people, as long as you give what they need or what they want, then they are going to cleave unto you. So they look for the Lord Jesus Christ and found him. But then in the process, the Lord Jesus Christ used his word in order to make them understand how it really is to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. And then after that, we came to one of the saddest verse in the Bible in John 6:66 or 666, where the Bible says, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Why? Because they were offended by the Word of God. Why? Because they do not like what they have heard. Why? Because it is not according to their preference what they have heard from the Word of God. Ladies and gentlemen, the Word of God will not adjust to us. We must conform to the Word of God. Amen? So if you are not going to accept God's Word as it is, then you are going to be unstable in your life. Number 6, distractions. Distractions, D-I-S-T-R-A-C-T-I-O-N-S. When we are distracted, when a person's heart is turned away from the Lord, he's facing the wrong direction. Because whenever you turn your back on God, that direction is always wrong. It may seem right in your eyes, it may seem right in your own estimation, but anyway, that is behind. Where God is behind you is a way that is going away from God. So you see, in this world, the devil has planted so many distractions in the way so that we will become unstable and we will not be able to really serve God, worship God, and love God in our lives. When our love for the Lord fades, and then it turned to something else, then we are going to be an unstable Christian. So the devil can use money to distract us. He can use opposite sex to distract us. He can use fame to distract us. And he can use so many things in this world at his disposal in order to distract us so that we will not grow in the grace and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And any person or any Christian who gets sidetracked by the devil is not going to progress in his spiritual life. One classic example of this is actually a person who is well known in the Bible, a person who is admired by so many people because of his wisdom, but wise as he was still distracted by the devil. Can we turn to 1 Kings chapter 11, verses 1 to 8? But King Solomon loved many strange women, together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonians, and Hittites, of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go in to them, neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clave unto this in love. So when you love something, you will cleave to it. When you love somebody, you will cleave to it. The Bible is very clear that we should not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. We know that, and yet we are still distracted because of the enticement that the devil is placing in our line of spiritual sight so that we will not be able to see the plan of God in our lives. And he had 700 wives. Hindi ka ba naman madistract? Princesses and 300 concubines. And his wives turned away his heart. Si Samson nga, isa lang eh. Diba? Si Delilah, nadali siya eh. Ito, 1,000. Sipin mong hirap na yan, no? For it came to pass when Solomon was old, that his wives turned away his heart after other gods. And his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of David, his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abominations of the Ammonites. And Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord. You see? Wise man. But he did evil in the sight of the Lord and went not fully after the Lord as did David, his father. Talagang pag ang example mo hindi maganda kahit wala ka na sa eksena, pag may nangyari, damay ka pa. Lagi talaga. Then did Solomon build an high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, in the hill that is before Jerusalem, and for Molech, the abomination of the children of Ammon. And likewise did he for all his strange wives, which burned incense and sacrifice unto their gods. Why did Solomon did all this evil in the sight of God? Because he got distracted. That's why we are admonished. That's why we are encouraged to look unto Jesus alone, the author and the finisher of our faith. Because looking at the left side will distract us. Looking on the right side will distract us. Looking on any other direction will distract us. But if we're going to look forward, look at the Lord Jesus Christ and keep on keeping on, then we'll be able to reach the finish line. Amen? And even though there are distractions along the way, as long as you cannot see them, you will not be distracted. Let us look at 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 10. Another example. This person is not as wise as Solomon, but he was a person who is worldly, and the Bible says, Demas hath forsaken me, Paul says, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica. You see, the Bible says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Why? These are just distractions. They are not the main thing for us as Christians, because the main thing for us is to follow God, to worship God, to glorify Him, and to do His will. In our lives, anything else is a distraction provided by the devil, so that we will not be able to give a good account of ourselves to God. As the Lord Jesus Christ gave an indictment in Revelation chapter 2, verse 8, to the church at Ephesus, nevertheless I have somewhat against thee, for thou hast left thy first love. So you see, every Christian, in order for us to become stable, we must not be distracted by anything, no matter what it is, that the devil is putting in our way. That's why it is very important for us to be a focus, to be serious, and to be looking only unto the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Because there are so many distractions along the way. You see, in our time today, there are so many distractions, especially when you are driving. Cell phone call is a distraction. Text messaging is a distraction. So many things. And we know what the result will be if you will be distracted while you are driving. It may cost you your life, or it will make you take another life. That is why it is very dangerous if we are not going to just look unto the Lord Jesus Christ and keep on obeying Him in our lives. Number 7, disregard for the Lord. Disregard for the Lord. You see, our life is a constant battle of wills. We need to understand that. It is a battle between our will and God's will. And most often than not, listen, we do not want to surrender our will, because our will make us happy. That is, at least that's what we think. At least that is what we believe. That if what we desire will only happen, then we are going to be happy or joyful in this life. We are forgetting that as a person in the flesh, even though we are saved, our will is always geared towards the Word. Because we are naturally pulled by the gravity of this Word. Meaning to say, pulled towards the center of sin. And therefore, when we lean unto our own understanding, then we are not going to find the path of the Lord, but what we're going to find is the path of destruction. But if in all our ways we will acknowledge Him, then we will see that the Lord will direct our path. So we should not disregard God. God must always be regarded in every aspect of our lives, in our plans, in our finances, in our ambitions, in everything that we desire in life. God must always be regarded instead of being disregarded. Whatever you want to do in your life, see to it that God is always the center of it, so that no matter what happens, we are going to fall unto the Lord instead of out of the will of God. As so many Christians today are disregarding the Lord. They do not care about the Word of God. They will not hearken to the preaching of the Word of God. They will not listen, or they will not obey what they are reading from the Word of God. They just don't care about the things that have something to do with God's will. Why? Because they have their own will. You see, for unbelievers, that's normal. The unbelievers will never seek the will of God. But for Christians, what is normal is to always seek God's will and to hearken unto the voice of God. If we're not going to do that, then we will remain unstable in our lives. Let's look at Judges chapter 2, verse number 17. The Bible says, and yet they would not hearken unto their judges. You see, God gave them judges. And these judges are the ones that is leading them to the Lord, guiding their step so that they will not go far away from God. But they would not hearken unto their judges, but they went a-whoring after other gods. Why? Because that is their will. That is their desire. They thought that other gods will give them happiness that the true and the living God will not give them. Well, of course, definitely, the true and the living God is not going to give us fleshly happiness. What the true and the living God will give us is spiritual happiness. But this God will give them spiritual, physical happiness. It will give them happiness that is only skin deep and will never last. And yet they hearken after other gods and bowed themselves unto them. They turned quickly out of the way which their fathers walked in, obeying the commandments of the Lord, but they did not so. Listen, our destruction is only a generation away. The annihilation of Christianity is always a generation away. Their fathers walked in the commandments of God, but their children quickly turned away and not walk in the commandments of the Lord. That's why if we're not going to train our children and teach them the word of God, then their generation will be the generation that will forget God and will usher in the destruction of this world. Number 8, difficulty. Difficulty. You see, problems can overwhelm people and it will make us unstable. When we have problems, the tendency for us is to panic instead of praying. You see, prayer is more effective than panic. Because when you panic, you're showing your hopelessness. But when you pray, you're showing your faith and trust in the Lord. Amen? That no matter what happens, God can help me and God can solve my difficulty. And that the power of God is available in my life. You see, in our lives, we often create mountains out of molehills. Minsan ang problema maliit, pero mahilig tayong magpalaki. Pag lumaki na, hirap na tayong akyatin. Kasi malaki na eh. Pero kung tutuusin, maliit lang. So instead of magnifying spiritual things, we tend to magnify our problems. You see, when David is facing Goliath, yes, it is true that Goliath is bigger than David. Actually, much bigger than David. He may be 4, 5, or even 6 times as David. But you see, Israel magnified Goliath that nobody wants to face him. All of them are trembling. They're so afraid. Even the tallest man living during that time in Israel, King Saul, trembled and would not even face Goliath. Why? Because he magnified Goliath. As big as he is, and yet he still magnified Goliath. But David is different. Even though Goliath is bigger than David, he did not magnify Goliath, but he magnified the Lord. He said, you may be big, but my God is bigger. You may be huge, but my God is humongous. You may be stronger than I, but my God is the Almighty God. And he said, I am going to you, I am going to face you, not with my might, not with my power, but with the power of God. And today God will give you unto me, and your carcass will be eaten by the fowls of the air. He went there in the power of God, and he went out victorious. Why? He magnified God instead of the problem. Diba? Minsan wala ka lang lunch, nagwala ka na. Wala na nga, nagwala ka pa, hindi wala-wala. Diba? Wala ka ng pera, nagwala ka pa, o di walang-wala. Oo. Diba? That is why we should not allow difficulty, listen, we should not allow difficulty to destroy or affect our faith in God. Because God is actually the God of the impossible. And difficulty is not yet impossible. It is just a very small matter when it comes to God. You see, our tendency is to avoid difficulty. When difficulty comes, do not try to change difficulty or difficult situations. You change yourself so that difficulty will not be difficult for you. Amen. It's our attitude when we are facing difficulties in life. It is our character when there are difficult situations. You see, what we've studied last Sunday regarding Daniel, he faced a difficult situation, but he was very calm, cool, and collected. Why? Because he trusts God. And he was able to solve that problem. Why? Because he is always apt to any kind of difficulty. If you will look at the first six chapters of Daniel, there are six difficulties that Daniel faced. And he was able to overcome each and every one of those difficulties. In chapter 1, the difficulty between about the diet. In chapter 2, the difficulty about the dream of Nebuchadnezzar. You see, Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. And he said, I was troubled. And he asked for all the magicians, astrologers, and Chaldeans. And he asked them, what is my dream and the interpretation? You see what the wise man says? You're asking for the impossible. They said, tell us your dream. And we will tell you the interpretation. Nebuchadnezzar said, no. Lolokohin niyo lang ako. If I will tell you what I dream about, then you will invent all kind of interpretation. So Nebuchadnezzar told them, I cannot remember it anymore. Make me remember my dream and give me the interpretation or else all of you will die. And then it came to the attention of Daniel. And he said, let me go to the king. And then he went to the king and he said, king, just give me a time and I will tell you your dream and the interpretation thereof. In the face of death, he was cool, calm, and he was collected. And then, the one that Brother Wilson preached, the danger of compromising his faith, when even though he will be thrown into the den of lion, he prayed. And he was able to overcome that. And then he told Belshazzar, tinimbang ka, ngunit kulang. The writing on the wall. He told the king. And then he was able to overcome that. And then you will see that Daniel did not allow any difficulty to affect his faith. Daniel is a constant person, stable person. Why? Because his faith in God is established. So I know that if our faith will only be established in the Lord, then there is nothing that can move us. There is nothing that can make us unstable like the Apostle Paul. He boldly pronounced, none of these things move me. None. You name it, Paul says, none of these things move me. Why? Because he says, I do not count my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course. He knew that when self is there, there is no way that you can finish your course. And he's doing that with the joy that God has given him, so that he may be able to glorify God in his life. Number 9, wrong companion. Wrong companion. Wrong companion will make you unstable. If your friends are unbelievers, or if your friends are backslidden Christian, those friends will make you unstable. That is why, as a child of God, as a Christian, we must always befriend people that will influence us to get nearer to God than away from God. That's why a believer with close friends with unbelievers is a believer that will never be stable in the faith, no matter what. It's impossible. No, Pastor, my friends are unbelievers, but I am a spiritual giant. That's impossible. Why? Because the Bible is truer than you. Look at what the Bible says, Proverbs 24:21. My son, fear thou the Lord and the King, and meddle not with them that are given to change. You see, these people are unstable, always changing. So what will happen to you if you are friends of these people? Look at 1 Corinthians 15:33. Paul is very clear. He said, be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. So you cannot grow as a Christian if your friends are unbelievers or backslidden Christians. There's just no way. Eh, dito nga sa church natin, meron tagal na, halos 15 taon na yatang Kristiyano. Hanggang ngayon, di lumagulago. Analago lang yung katawan. Bakit? Eh, hindi tumigil ng pakikipagkaibigan sa unbeliever. Oh, tapos, isa pa sa nagrebelde. Sa tagal-tagal na nakakapakinig ng Word of God. Alam mo kapatid, makinig ka lang ng Word of God, ano man na mangyari sa'yo, may hindi ka man magustuhan, hindi ka magre-rebelde. Aalis ka, kung aalis ka, pero aalis ka ng maayos. Why? Because you know what is right according to the Word of God. But to rebel against the church, to rebel against the man of God, to rebel against the people of God, only proves that you are so backslidden or you may not even be saved. Why? Bakit ka mag... Ba't mawawasakin ang gawain ng Diyos? Anong mapapala mo? Oh. Ay, nawasak yung simbahan. Oh. Nag-comment-comment pa sila. Sabi ng isang, wala na rito, naitiwalag na natin. Sabi niya, nagtagal lang, pero at least na-realize nyo. At nakita nyo kung ano. Ang tama. Praise the Lord, kanya. Pagpalain kayo ng Diyos. Kanya. Doon sa mga nagrebelde at umalis. Pagpalain kayo ng Panginoon. Sabi mo sa rebelde, pagpalain ka ng Diyos. Sa bagay, hindi nakapagtataka kasi yung taong yun, pinagmalaki niya, sabi niya ako, nakapagpalayas na ako ng pastor. Oh. Tuwan-tuwa siya. Ba't ang matutuwa, nagpalayas ako ng pastor? Dapat nga, nalulungkot ako, imbis na sana akong gamitin ng Diyos para yung pastor manatili o kaya at least ma-encourage, abay, ako pa naging dahilan kung bakit siya napalayas. Maliman ang ginagawa niya, it is not our part to destroy people. Our part is to help them grow in the Lord. Amen? And that is what a degenerate, unbelieving friends will do to you. It will make you unstable. Number 10, discouragement. and doubt will make you unstable. You see, when a person begins to doubt God, the door is now open for Satan to make his move in that person. Satan will seldom work in the lives of Christians who are settled in the Lord. But when doubt comes in, then that's the time that Satan will throw everything at you, because you are wide open for all kind of deception and all kind of discouragement. You see, it is so sad when a person comes to a point in time that he believes his doubts and he doubted his belief. That's a sad thing. That you believe your doubts, but you doubted your beliefs. And when that comes, then you're going to be unstable, you're going to be discouraged. Mark that person, and he's not going to be used by God in the ministry. But you see, yes, we are in the flesh. Yes, we are limited. But we have a God who is ready to help us and supply us whatever we need. Like for example, Pastor, I am not a wise person, but you can ask God for wisdom, James 1, 5 and 6. The Bible is very clear. Even if you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. But give it to all men liberally. Kung magbigayin Diyos ng wisdom, at hindi marami. And upbraid it not, hindi nagpipigil. And it shall be given him. God will supply the wisdom if he will ask. But let him ask in faith. Nothing wavering, not unstable. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. Can we continue? For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. You see, when you pray and you doubt, don't pray. Why? You're wasting your time. But when we pray, we need to believe. But Pastor, what if what I'm praying is wrong? Well, at least it is better to believe what you are praying about, even though it may be wrong, than not to believe at all in your prayer. Because if your heart is right and your heart is fervent, and you may be wrong in what you're thinking, God can still answer your prayer according to his own wisdom and according to what we actually need. Look at Hebrews 10:23. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promise. So don't waver, don't doubt. If you believe it, be established, stay with it. Ito nyo. Ang problema kasi natin, yung paniniwala natin ng ating ginagawa, imbis na yung kung ano yung paniniwalang dapat nating ilagak sa Panginoong Diyos. Tulad nga yung sinabi ko nung nakaraan, alam na natin ang katotohanan. Alam na natin ang maraming bagay. Pagkatapos, pagpanahon na tayo na yung gagawa para patunayan natin yung ating pinaniniwalaan o napatunayan, ay mapapatunayan natin na hindi pala tayo tunay. Oh, di ba? Kamukha nitong pandemic, tayong lahat tuwang-tuwa. Hindi dahil may pandemic. Sapagkat kahit may pandemic, nakita natin ang biyaya ng Diyos. Walang nagutom. Oh. Iba, hirap na hirap. Iba, marahil nagutom. Yung iba, hindi alam ang gagawin. Pero ang Diyos, binigyan tayo ng wisdom at ng provision, gumamit ng tao at ang church. Yung naipon natin pera para magamit natin during the pandemic. Tapos natapos ang pandemic. Ay, hindi pa pala tapos, pero nagkatrabaho na tayo. Tapos kumita kayo kahit konti lang. Tapos hindi mo pa ibinigay yung dapat mo ibigay sa Panginoon maging matapat sa simbahan. Oh. Bakit ganun? Eh kasi sa isip mo, kailangan ko kasi. Talaga naman, lahat naman kailangan eh. Oh. Pero, yung patunay na talagang nagpapasalamat ka sa Diyos at nagtiwala ka sa Kanya nung panahon na yon? Eh kung ikatwiran ko, ay hindi, walang pakain kasi kailangan ng chest ang pera. Ah, anong magiging tingin nyo? Mapambira si Pastor, hindi ang kaming magutom. Huwag lang gastusin yung pera ng church. Eh, ang church kami. Tayo. O, hindi ba? O. So, ano sabi? It's good to do good. Whenever there is an opportunity, let us do good to all men. Especially, unto the household of faith. Huwag ka maniwala sa diablo. Niniwala kasi sa demonyo eh. Pag may binulong sa'yo, yun ang paniwalaan mo. Imbis na ang paniwalaan mo, ang Panginoong Diyos. Number 11. Tapusin natin to, 38 lang naman. Number 11, confusion. Confusion can create instability in our lives. If we are inconsistent, it will breed confusion. It may not be on our side, but on the part of those people that are looking at us. Amen? As Christians, there are people looking at you, at me. And when we act differently, they will be confused. And once they are confused, they will become unstable. And when people becomes unstable, it may also affect us. Because it can never encourage you if you know that you discourage other people. Amen? Except when you are telling the truth. Except when you're preaching the truth. Except when you are helping them to understand what they should do as a child of God. Look at what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 14:8. If the trumpet gave an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to the battle? You see, trumpets are very important in the olden times. Because they are used for go to the battle or retreat. So if you make an uncertain sound and they are in the middle of the battle, what will they do? How are they going to respond when things are confusing? When we are sending them a wrong signal in our lives? It's different when the only thing that you know is really to serve God and to glorify God in your life. And there is no quitting in your vocabulary. That may be different. But if you are assigned a job to do, to let our light shine, and it did not shine, then it will confuse other people. But there is an exemption. Like for example, there is a story when there is a battle and this group of soldiers went into the battle. But in that battle, after maybe 8 hours of non-stop battle, they are losing that particular battle. And then the general said, he asked the bugle boy and he said, "You play the sound of retreat because we're losing our soldiers." But the boy said, "Sir, I cannot do it." He said, "Why?" "I do not know the sound of defeat, a retreat. I do not know the sound of that we are not going to go on with the battle anymore. It doesn't matter. Just play. Just make a sound so that our people will do something about it." And then he played the only tune that he knows. And that is the tune of charge into the battle. And when he played that, instead of retreating, of course the soldier charged, thinking that help is on the way. And the enemy is also taught that even though they are winning, that reinforcement is on the way. So they lose heart. And the soldiers gathered strength and encouragement. And they turned the tide of the battle. Because that bugle boy does not know how to sound or to play the sound of retreat. They keep on fighting. And as a Christian, Yes, confusion may happen. But if we know God's will in our lives, we must keep on keeping on. Amen? And then lastly, a weak foundation in our Christian life. Matthew 7, 25 to 27. If our foundation is weak, then we're unstable. Matthew 7, 25 to 27. So you know the story, right? The man who built his house upon sand, and the man who built his house upon the rock, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and still blowing, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. So if your foundation is strong, you will be stable. But look at this one. And everyone that heareth this saying of mine and doeth them shall not be likened to the foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon the house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. So our faith, our life must be founded on the Word of God. Because if our foundation is the sure Word of God, if our foundation is something that cannot be shaken, and it is strong, it is firm. You see, we have a song, How Firm a Foundation. And if our foundation is the rock, the Lord Jesus Christ, then we are going to be a stable Christian, and we are going to have good success. But if not, then we will fail. We will become unstable, we will fail, and we will waste our life as a Christian. So I hope and I pray that we are going to be a stable Christian. But it needs will. Will to follow the will of God. Will to endure the hardness of life. Will to keep on keeping on, even though there are difficulties, discouragement, even though doubts may come in our lives. Because if we are going to be deep into the Word of God, then we cannot easily be uprooted by anything that Satan can throw at us. But we will become stronger through adversities and through problems that we are going to face in life. So let us make this book of the law to be a mighty part of our lives, and that we will study it, that we may be approved to God, and that we will meditate upon it day and night, and that we are going to share them to our children when we are standing, when we are sitting, when we are walking, when we are lying down, and that we are going to hide it in our hearts, that we might not sin against God. Shall we stand up, please? Father, we thank you for